The Sound Off Podcast. The podcast about broadcast with Matt Kundel. Starts now.
One of the big broadcast-to-podcast success stories is Real Talk with Ryan Jespersen. Over a year ago, Ryan was let go from 630 Chet in Edmonton, and by November of 2020, he was back with his show, but on a completely different platform, digital, which of course includes YouTube and podcast and now some streaming options. I think my biggest takeaway is how from day one, the presentation was clean and professional, which is kind of a must if you're going to play in the news talk territory. The timing was also right with the pandemic creating more online media consumers. We're going to talk about a few things, including Ryan's shift to digital, and we're going to get ankle deep into Alberta politics because it does play a key role in all this. And if you're not up on your Alberta politics, think of Alberta as Diet Texas, with the conservative politics of Ralph Klein having been replaced by the current Jason Kenney dumpster fire. Ryan Jespersen joins me from the studios of Real Talk in Edmonton.
Ryan, thanks for joining me on the podcast today.
Well, thanks for the invitation. I appreciate it.
When did you start in radio?
My first job in radio was on the heels of my first job in newspaper, and my first shift in radio was on December 6th, 2004. No, that's a lie. 2005. So what's that? 16 years ago.
So what station was it?
It was the Jimmy Pattison stations in Red Deer, Alberta. It's Big 105 and 106.7 The Drive. And a little known fact, because nobody else besides me would care about this, but my first job in broadcasting was the exact same position as Ron McLean's first job in broadcasting. So that was always my early reason for optimism.
And I think with reason, too, because when you look at somebody like Terry DeMonte, he started in Churchill, but so did Peter Mansbridge.
100%. Peter was on my show, Real Talk, a little while ago. And, you know, everybody sort of, I think, is familiar with the story of him announcing, making airport announcements in Churchill, Manitoba, and getting scouted by a CBC executive or at least a station executive who I don't think probably had any idea at the time the magnitude of approaching this young airport employee. But everybody starts somewhere. And I think probably maybe now more than ever in media, people need to believe that there could be promise despite what appears to be a whole bunch of hurdles and a whole bunch of reasons not to do it in the early stages of the career.
But you're playing the hits on Big 105 in Red Deer. You're playing it for the people of Red Deer and also for everybody going from Calgary to Edmonton, but everybody going from Edmonton to Calgary, they're listening. Did you think you'd be playing the hits for a long time? And how did you move over to talk?
It was kind of actually a really interesting setup and an interesting format. And quite honestly, I don't know if they still do it this way, but I was news anchoring and reporting. So they'd break away this, you know, Big 105 was kind of the listen at work station, like the AC kind of, you know, and the station, you know, the 25 to 54 crowd would listen to. And we'd cut in with the big news stinger at the top of the hour. And we'd have 3 minutes to kind of tell everybody the stories that they needed to know about the region. Didn't spend a lot of time covering national news. They were great. They were fine. As an employer, they were fine. But I always sort of felt like this wasn't going to be a long-term arrangement. I wanted to be able to sink my teeth into something with a little bit more substance on the news front, but obviously a great foot in the door. Matt, when I was first out there, this was sort of in the waning days of TV demos on VHS tapes. And so I know, because I paid out of pocket for it at the time, that I had 75 VHS tapes dubbed from my practicum with CTV in Saskatoon and Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, and some of the work that I had done at State Polytechnic, which is where I did my broadcasting diploma. And I know that I distributed most of them in person, driving everywhere from Nanaimo into Manitoba, getting interviews with program directors, news directors, station managers. Really wanted that first job to be in TV, but to no avail. And it was 9 months of a job hunt, and it was bartending along the way, and you know, getting, quite frankly, pretty discouraged. And then this radio job opened. The first radio job that I applied for was that one, and I got it. And can I say the rest is history? I'm still, of course, a very young man, so might be a little early to proclaim that.
So where did you go after Big?
After Big, it was kind of an interesting scenario. City TV which had been Craig Media and Chum had been trying to acquire broadcast licenses in Alberta with no luck. And so I think most people are familiar with the story. Chum came in and bought the A channels and rebranded them to City TV. And City TV, to the best of my understanding, had been operating in contravention of its CRTC license in that it did not have a bureau open in Red Deer. And so I think that they were trying to expedite opening a Red Deer bureau for City TV coverage down there. I drove up to Edmonton. I walked into that newsroom. I saw the opening and I told the news director there, "You can tell your reporters that I said this. If you hire me, nobody will work harder than me." And I got about halfway back down driving from Edmonton to Red Deer and he gave me a call and offered me the job. I opened up that bureau. It was no frills. I'll tell you, like I was pulling clips, pulling time codes, literally shuttling tape back and forth on this camera, using my own laptop that I had left over from State, working out of my apartment, ultimately got some office space and really built that brand in that region, or started building it at least, grassroots style. I was down there for about 10 months with City TV, got called up and moved to Edmonton. And that was New Year's Eve of 2006. So yeah, coming up on 15 years in Edmonton too.
Knowing where I know where the story goes, the fact that you had to assemble everything together and start something completely from scratch has obviously played into well to what you're doing now.
Yeah. I mean, then, and that's not lost on me. And I appreciate you making that point. I feel like my career to this point, my first job, I kind of stumbled into, I had some good fortune early on in my career. My first job in print, my first paid job in media was at the Calgary Herald, which was incredible. I mean, I grew up in Calgary. I mean, you know, a top five paper in the country, circulation wise at the time anyway, and to have an opportunity. I wasn't exactly A1 front fold all the time, but still to be part of that team was an incredible opportunity. And so I'd worked for some big brands, obviously at now known as Post Media. But I've also worked a lot on the underdogs, you know, City TV in Central Alberta certainly qualified at that time. And then ultimately my work, you know, with City TV in Edmonton, hosting breakfast television again against big legacy morning brands as kind of the irreverent, more fun TV show. And then, of course, back to a big dog with Corus Radio. And then now as what we're doing independently, it's been back and forth. And I've loved every minute of it. I mean, you take something, not just as a broadcaster, but in my case now as an entrepreneur, and try to learn something from every perspective, from working at the big legacy brands to working at the brands that are building that, quite frankly, most people are not familiar with based on, you know, how it goes, media consumption habits. People don't move around a lot. They've got to be convinced. They've got to be prompted to break away, which is what makes it tough to grow ratings. But I love the challenge.
Yeah, I like that you mentioned that you've worked for both the heritage brands and also, you know, the upstarts. And I want to just take you back to the Calgary Herald. How do you look at the demise of newspapers over the last 25 some odd years?
Well, I mean, with a pit in my stomach, for starters, I obviously it's impacted a lot of people that I know, a lot of people that you know, I'm sure. And it's really frustrating. It's too bad to see. Yeah, I mean, I feel like I could answer this question for an hour and a half, but it's frustrating to see who's calling the shots. It's frustrating to see to whom these boards are beholden and some of the decisions that are made, the death of the small town newspaper. I mean, I think back to my days in Red Deer. Back in, you know, 15 years ago, you had RDTV, which was like a global affiliate, an ITV global affiliate at the time. You had this intensely competitive radio market. Red Deer, at that point anyway, was one of the most competitive media markets that I've ever been aware of. You had the Red Deer Express. You had the Red Deer Advocate, both of them newspapers, the Express publishing. I think it was weekly and the Advocate a daily. And then plus, you know, all of the subsidiary or, you know, the bedroom communities, you might call them, I guess, out of Sylvan Lake and Lacombe and all these other. And this is just in Central Alberta, you know, 300,000 people within, let's say, a 45-minute drive. And then you go big picture, of course, it's a little bit of a different story where you've still got coverage. The newspapers are getting smaller and the advertising model's a little bit different, but there's not the attention shown. Everybody knows this, in particular in politics, like in government, in the courts, in corporate accountability and environmental reporting. You've got these talented journalists that are being paid less than they've ever been paid to do more than they've ever done. And the overload on them is significant. And ultimately, when I talk about a big overarching theme, what really blows my mind is that with advance notice, You know, if these newspapers, I guess, are the Titanic, how did they not see this coming? This incredibly significant shift in where advertising was going and how content was being monetized and how journalism was going to survive. And it's just like, you know, the people in the biggest corner offices, I guess, were just asleep at the switch, because I don't know how else you explain what happened and how they were so ill-equipped to deal with it.
Well, journalism's expensive and content creation is expensive. And nobody wants to make decisions that are expensive because it involves a lot of risk-taking.
It involves risk-taking, and maybe if this is an indictment on the public, I don't know, maybe there is a lack of appreciation for... Although I also don't know if I believe this, because back in the day, if you think about it, you feel like the newspaper, I mean, if you think back to the paper delivery boy or girl with their wagon and like throwing the newspapers at the front door, and it was like every house or every second house was getting the newspaper. And do we believe now that every house or every second house is paying for a digital subscription or digital access to a newspaper or to several newspapers or magazines or podcasts or whatever? I'm not sure. I don't think so. It seems to me to be, now I do believe that a lot of information does need to be accessible in front of paywalls. But at the same time, you're right. It is expensive to produce and it's important. And I guess the question is ultimately, how does the public reflect its priorities and its appreciation, if I can, for quality journalism and for, you know, storytelling and accountability and all of the things that come with it? And at the same time, how do you convince these corporations that it's worth the investment? Sometimes I don't think that newspapers assigning somebody to cover a trial for 3 months or assigning somebody to do a deep dive on a long form piece would have been looking at it solely through the lens of revenue generation. But ultimately, when all decisions are made in the context of return to shareholders, you start to skew. And ultimately, I think we're seeing what happens over the course of time when that's the case.
How did you find your way onto Ched?
So I'd been hosting breakfast television for about 6 years and, you know, sort of news magazine format, you know, wake up with us in the morning, 5 to 9 a.m. type deal. Obviously, we had the news traffic weather wheel, which was outside of my purvey. I was, you know, the in-studio host. I got to do all the fun stuff and, you know, I'd interview the politicians, but I'd also do cooking segments and we'd have bands and comedians. And it was, a really incredible experience. It was a lot of fun. I was in my early 30s, mid 30s and just an amazing opportunity. But I think I started to, I don't know if I want to say outgrow the role, but I started, you know, to evolve with regards to the type of broadcasting I wanted to do or how I wanted to, you know, thought I could use those platforms or the sorts of lights that I thought I could shine on important issues. You know, I was coming up to the end of a contract. I mean, this is years removed now, so obviously I can talk about it, but the contract negotiations weren't going great. The company and I had different perceptions of my value. And quite frankly, I was looking for an indication that I wasn't just going to languish on the farm team forever. And I wanted to know, like, if I would be hosting Breakfast Television Toronto or Breakfast Television Vancouver at some point, and if I was part of that plan. And every indication that I got back was that just kind of wasn't the case. And sometimes there's just not always a fit. And that's fine. I guess my mind was open to a move, but I wasn't about to blow everything up if a move wasn't there at the time. Right around this same time, there's some goings on in Alberta. There's a new premier in Jim Prentice, a high-profile former cabinet minister, had come back to Alberta, and he was going to save the Alberta progressive conservative brand, which had taken a big hit under Premier Alison Redford. And, you know, there was these rumblings that Rachel Notley and her upstart party, the NDP party with four members in the Legislative Assembly, might challenge the PCs and form government. And so there was a lot of attention being paid to Alberta politics. And of course, this has always been of interest to me. And so one morning on breakfast television, we have a chat segment set aside and I was feeling ornery about a couple of things that I thought deserved strong comment. And so I delivered on that for about 4 minutes. And it was somewhat out of character for the host that I played on TV. I'm really proud of it. The Huffington Post pushed it out that day and said, if you watch 4 minutes of anything today, watch this. And literally the next day, an executive from Corus reached out and asked if I'd be interested in grabbing lunch. And we did. And they talked to me about talk radio and wondered if that had ever been on my radar. And of course it had been, but I thought that I might do talk as I rode off into the sunset. I always saw talk as something I might do from, you know, like age 55 to 65 or something like that. I saw the window open and I decided to make the jump, let my contract expire at BT, and was on the air with a new show 2 weeks later.
Who is the exec who took you to lunch?
Sid Smith.
I ask these questions because I've met all these people and I know all the characters, but this does absolutely nothing for the listener.
Yeah, well, that's okay. I mean, to make it interesting for the listener, the same people that provided me all the opportunities 7 years ago are also all of the ones that contributed to that window closing about a year ago. So, of course, when I look back on all of this, the dismissal is more fresh than the hiring. So as anybody would, because I'm human, I sometimes have mixed feelings talking about some people that have had a big impact on my career. That's me keeping it real for your podcast.
I think back to that spot and that time slot and the people who've hosted it over the years. So when I lived in Edmonton, it was Rutherford and it was guns blazing and talk radio. I mean, it was really at a very irreverent point, but I think much like Alberta began to develop a little bit of a conscious and common sense approach, you know, in Edmonton especially, what did you bring into that spot, you know, in contrast to what it had been in the past?
Yeah. And I'd always had a ton of respect for Dave Rutherford and for Charles Adler and for all of these voices that I had heard on talk radio across the country. I was always kind of the weird kid that, like, at 15, 16 years old, I'd listen to talk radio. I mean, that was always something that had intrigued me in the art of storytelling and how stories were told and how audience engagement was leveraged to make a show more exciting or more captivating. But yeah, I mean, with Sid and that lunch that we had a really great and frank conversation. It's funny when you're talking about hiring for talk radio, there will be questions asked through the course of a casual job interview that you could never ask in so many other jobs, like, tell us about your politics. And I remember having a conversation with him and saying, you know, I would categorize myself. I mean, 630 Ched has been this conservative legacy brand for decades. I remember saying to him, you know, consider myself to be a progressive conservative, small p, small c, but I'm all for marriage equality. And keep in mind, cannabis wasn't legal yet in Canada. And I said, I'm in favor of legalized cannabis and I would be supportive of compassionate medical assistance in dying. These are a few of the things that are important to me. And if you put me on the radio, I will reflect those priorities. He said, perfect. I mean, the mandate fairly clearly spelled out was to grow the audience in a younger, higher spending demographic. And for 6 years, that's what we did.
Is there a home for somebody who's small p, small c at the federal level? Because I'm currently looking for one.
Yeah. Well, it's called Real Talk Ryan Jespersen, and you can download it every day. And but no, I know exactly what you're saying. And this is what I endeavor to find out, because I think that I can't say the majority of people are that. That's not for me to say. But I do believe that there are millions of Canadians, and I do believe there are a couple million Albertans, to talk about my home province, that would qualify as that, that believe that a government's got to be lean, or as lean as possible, while still observing and supporting commonly held values and beliefs, that society's got to provide resources for people that are marginalized or under-resourced, or, you know, living in, with modest incomes or living in poverty. I think that there's got to be strong social programs, but I believe that there is a real balance to be found. And I think right now politics feels so polarized that I'm not even sure if you ask somebody to explain the nuance of their position on politics, like, hey, where might you lean a little right? Or, hey, where might you lean a little left? Because I think most people do. I'm not sure that a lot of people would even care to participate in that exercise. I feel like people are picking teams based on factors that have nothing to do with how they believe societies should function. And it concerns me a great deal.
Well, that's good. I'm glad I have a home now, because it's been a bit of a dumpster fire. In the 90s, it was Ralph Klein's conservatives. That's what I identified with and understood. And, you know, for a time, it was Joe Clark's conservatives that I understood. And I totally get Brian Mulroney. It was the party of the environment. And none of that exists anymore. I don't even understand what these big blue sea conservatives are all about. So I find myself orphaned, essentially.
I feel like I want to talk about Ralph Klein and my relationship with Ralph Klein as like a kid growing up in Calgary. He was my mayor, and I remember his ascension to provincial politics. He was the environment minister. He ran for leadership. He became the premier. I remember my first act of, I guess what would probably qualify as my first X on the calendar when it comes to activism, so to speak, was walking out of high school one day, along with hundreds of other students at our high school, marching down Elbow Drive in Calgary toward the Olympic Plaza downtown outside City Hall, meeting up with thousands of other students from dozens of other high schools. This is well documented. People can Google it. To protest education cuts that were being introduced by Ralph Klein, and feeling angst about that and defending our teachers were, you know, some of them threatening to suspend us if we participated and if we left, and others explaining to us what those budget cuts meant, in particular in the arts and in the creative, you know, all those sort of creative opportunities you have in high school. Or I remember different teachers trying to help us understand, and this was our early understanding as 15, 16, 17 year olds, about, you know, how budgets impact people and how numbers are more than, these things are more than spreadsheets. These are expressions of priorities by government and by the population, and that complicated understanding of Ralph Klein, and then the opportunity to interview him and what a veteran he was, a former journalist himself. And I mean, the guy would just hold court in media scrums. I've never interviewed another politician quite like him. I say to this day, like, I'm a Klein guy, and people are like, you're a Klein guy? People that, like, really? Like the guy that, you know, is supportive publicly of all these lefty type things. Well, what does that mean? Lefty, like marriage equality? Really? If you're a conservative now, does that mean you're against marriage equality? Because I don't think most people that are involved politically want to start being painted into these corners when it comes to things that revolve around decency. I mean, right now, if you think about it, and anybody listening to this can participate in this exercise, if you had to assign a political party to the like anti-mask, anti-vax movement, and you couldn't say the PPC because they've obviously cornered the market on it. But if you had to say of the big parties, of the NDP, the Liberals, and the Conservatives, which party would you say is anti-mask, anti-vax? And the majority of people would say it's the Conservatives. But I know many Conservatives that are absolutely pro-vaccine. They're doing their best to get society back on track. They care about their fellow human beings. They'll make those sacrifices or take those steps. So I think that politics has gotten off the rails of what it's supposed to be all about.
I might also suggest that a number of those people stayed home on election day.
100%. Absolutely. It's sort of the apathy around it. I don't, you know, we've just had municipal elections in Alberta, I guess about 10 days ago now, at least when we're recording this. And the federal election was what now? I guess something like a month and a half ago or something. And you're right. I mean, voter turnout, we go in the city of Edmonton or city of Calgary, 39, 49%. We're like, ooh, you know, like that's brutal. I don't know. I don't know if you want to start going into, I mean, we can talk about Australia and places where it's, you have to vote, kind of like taking part in a census. I don't know that that's the answer. I don't think that is the answer. I think part of democracy is, you know, having the right to withdraw one's participation, but it's frustrating to me. I guess I could go back to, you know, beat that drum of if you don't vote, don't bitch.
I actually considered asking for a form to decline my vote, which you can do.
Yeah, but why not? Like, that's what I'm saying, is that I think that that is democratic participation, which is why I have mixed feelings. I don't think forcing people to vote is the right thing, because I think then you run the risk. I mean, there are probably many reasons, and you could bring maybe more a philosopher on to talk about it that would be more well-versed than me. But if you start forcing people to participate in something, I'd be concerned about the results of that, right? Because all of a sudden, if it turns into an exercise of protest and that's who you're stuck with, that the end result of this protest is who you're stuck with as your democratically elected representative, that sounds like a potential nightmare to me.
In just a second, Ryan and I talk about building Real Talk. How much did it cost? What are the metrics like? And how does he get all those A-list guests? And the show is more than just politics. It's lifestyle, human interest, and stories. And how did he go about replacing that ever-so-reliable paycheck? How's the show monetized? All that and more coming up in just a sec. And all the connection points to Ryan's show and some additional material can be found at soundoffpodcast.com.
The Sound Off Podcast with Matt Kundle.
What'd you like about your time at Ched?
Oh, so much. I don't talk too much publicly about getting canned, but I do want to make one thing clear, and that's that I did not get fired by 630 Ched. I got fired by Corus, and that's a big difference. My former colleagues at that radio station, many of them very good friends who remain very good friends, had a huge impact on my career, huge impact on my life. I love many of them. What did I love? I mean, what a privilege. What an opportunity to, like you talked about, that time slot. It's the flagship time slot, 9 to noon weekdays on 630 Ched. That's the time slot you want, you know, to be able to host really meaningful conversations and to be able to grow an audience and to be able to build my own brand, quite frankly, which worked out for me in the end, or continue to build that brand. That was all really great. We did some amazing things. We raised a ton of money for charity. There's a lot to love. I look back on those 6 years with absolute fond memories and zero regrets.
So why did Corus can you?
Well, they canned me, I think, probably for a number of reasons. People that they really like really didn't like me. And there was an adversarial relationship, I would say, partially of my doing. And, you know, I say to you, zero regrets with intent. But I was, you know, critical of Alberta Premier Jason Kenney's leadership, his leadership run, his election campaign, some of the things that he gave a pass to, including some candidates with homophobic pasts. And I said as much on the national airwaves with Charles Adler on Charles Adler Tonight. And that was, I think, the declaration of war. And then I started getting blacklisted from interviews. And then ultimately, there was a dust up with a former Edmonton city councilor who was just absolutely trounced in the Edmonton mayoral race. And so he'll fade off into obscurity. But that created a coordinated effort of people behind the scenes. And you can read about it in my book someday. And ultimately, the company made a decision to prioritize them over me. And quite frankly, looking back on it, just over a year ago, it's worked out all right for me.
Yeah, so I look back at my time in the 90s, and you're referring to Mike Nickel, and I'm going to mention this because Mike Nickel had a couple of runs for city councilor back in the 90s, and you know he had, I think, two or three defeats during the time that I was there. And you know whether it was people with signs and come pick up your damn signs and don't vote for this. We could go on the air and talk about this because I was working at the Bear and there was nothing that you couldn't say, and I had too much of a political jibber-jabber going with myself. But I thought rock talk and politics mixed. I had no problem talking about that in the afternoon. We actually had Alan Rock, who was enemy number one in Alberta, come and sit on my show. We wound up talking about John Lennon and him meeting John Lennon. And people thought we were going to talk about guns and divorce and whatever the other wacky stuff of 1997 was. But I've always loved that combination. Politically, I find that very surprising that you found yourself in that spot. And especially like a year later, like, where's Jason Kenney and where are you?
Like, where's Mike Nickel? Where's Kerry Diott? Where's Jason Kenney? I think that my audience would give me better than 22% approval right now. And so we'll see. I mean, if Jason Kenney remains leader of the UCP and runs in this next election and loses, and if Real Talk is still doing 100,000 downloads a week, then I guess it remains to be seen who made the right call. It honestly, you know, Matt, it's been interesting with my career. There were these 6 year runs. It's maybe, I mean, I have very happily married and my wife's amazing and we've been married for 12 years now, but everybody talks about that 7 year itch in regards to personal relationships. I found that for me, I hosted breakfast television for 6 years. It came to an end. Everything ended amicably. My contract ended. I walked away. Nobody got fired. Nobody quit. 6 years at Ched. Obviously, I didn't look to get fired. To be honest, I was gobsmacked when I was fired. I didn't see it coming. I knew that at some point the rubber was going to hit the road and something was going to happen, but I didn't think it would happen the way that it did. But again, a 6 year window. I was the in-game host for the Edmonton Oilers for 6 years. Again, that ended amicably. Everything's great there. We're still on wonderful terms. But my career seems to have had these 6 year kind of blocks. And I don't know whether I've lost interest or whether I've wanted to take a leap and try something new or apply myself to something different. It's kind of interesting how that period of time, that 6 years, has occurred three different times in three different applications.
That's a natural broadcast cycle. It takes 3 years to build your audience, and then you're going to spend 3 years to enjoy it. And then after that, it kind of wears out. Ask me how many years I spent in Edmonton.
How many years were you there?
Seven.
Seven. There you go. Right? It's kind of interesting. And I think that if I was still hosting breakfast television, this is nothing against anybody. I mean, I worked with some people I just adore there, but I would be bored out of my mind right now. And if I was still on Ched, I mean, you know, talk radio, it's never boring. But at the same time, I'd probably be going, okay, what's next? Right? Like, what's next? And now with what we're doing with Real Talk, there are so many challenges and opportunities and unknowns that it's like infused so much energy into every single element of my life. It's been like this refresh, this complete fresh start, you know, at an age where I still have a lot of time to do it, which I think if this would have happened 5 or 10 years later, I think it'd be a little bit more nerve wracking.
I get the feeling, though, that because you got this up and started in the period of time that you did, that you had been thinking about this for a long time.
Yeah. I'm just trying to remember if I've ever said this publicly before. I don't think that I have, but my previous contract negotiations at Corus had not been great to the point where I signed. I felt sick when I signed. I felt demoralized and disrespected. And my wife and I had resolved to be open to use the duration of that contract, that 3 years, to figure out what was going to be next. And maybe it would be within that broadcast family, right? But maybe it would be in Vancouver or Toronto or doing something else or moving back to TV. I always wanted to do talk on TV. So I hadn't said that I was going to leave, but it was on our radar that I wasn't just going to keep plodding away doing the same thing year after year after year. So yes, there had been some cocktail napkin type planning, but it was very bare bones. Like, the show wasn't named. We hadn't solved any of the technical hurdles. Like, how are you going to live stream and televise every day? And what would the podcast model look like? And how would you monetize it? And all of that kind of stuff. But certainly there were ideas that were brewing. So when I, you know, was like punched between the eyes and sent packing, I mean, let me tell you this, I got fired on a Friday at 9 o'clock in the morning. And that Friday at 7:30 in the morning, I met my self-appointed transition team for breakfast. So I was already meeting with people before I took the call, because we knew it was, we saw it from a mile away.
I'm hearing about those things that you wanted to do in your head. I mean, putting the show on TV, that's not new, because Rutherford was on TV back in the 90s. Getting it on podcast, that's not new, because Corus was in the process of developing Curious Cast. So podcast is not out of their reach. So is it possible that they're really not interested in building your brand?
Well, and this is what was always hard for me to resolve, was that, you know, I was federal election night 2019, flown out to Toronto and sitting on the national desk. So I knew that they valued the perspective. And I think, you know, if I can say, the success of the show was unignorable. The show's audience was growing. It was always high rated. It was sold out, essentially, although they'd always say to me, because I'd use that to clap back at people. And they'd be like, can you please stop saying on the air that the show is sold out? It's never sold out. We can always create more space. But the point was, it was doing well and it was generating revenue. So I knew that there was reason to believe that I should have a bright future there. I don't think it was politics either, because Corus is a national company. You put me in Vancouver and I would be a conservative radio host, right? If you put me in Toronto, I'd be a conservative radio host. If you put me in Alberta, all of a sudden people start calling me like a progressive radio host. But nothing changes when I fly an hour or, you know, west, or 3 hours east.
Is there anybody else doing what you're doing in Canada?
I mean, not exactly. Rod Peterson's an interesting example in Saskatchewan with his sports show. And Rod's obviously a broadcast veteran and he's built his brand for a lot of years. And I'm paying keen attention to what he's doing. And he's always been supportive of us. But other than that, I mean, I guess there's the story of what I'm doing with my show with Real Talk, Ryan Jespersen, and then there's our company, Relay, which is really in its infancy. But Relay, I think, will become more of a household name in months and years to come, and we have pretty big plans that would extend far beyond what I'm doing with my show.
How much were your startup costs?
About $40,000.
Nice.
Yeah.
And you obviously had some great partners, so who helped out when you're talking about like a planning team?
Yeah. You mean by name? I mean, we had sponsors that were incredible. I had some endorsement contracts that were already in place, you know, with people that were advertising on my previous radio show. And when I got canned, they were in touch with me. I mean, I think of like Held Automotive Group. So, you know, they own Mercedes-Benz, Edmonton West, and Sherwood and St. Albert Dodge. And Scott Held, the president of the company, calls me within an hour of me getting canned because Chad's sales reps had started calling the clients to sort of try to obviously figure this all out. And he called me. He was the first one to call me. You know what he said? I mean, I'm sitting there. Matt, the people that cheered for my failure, the people that reveled in my firing, one of the things that they would point out, I saw it ad nauseum on social media. I love that this guy's got to hand back the keys to the Mercedes. They just loved it. They loved that I was handing back the keys. And Scott called me and said that the last thing you need to worry about is what your family's going to do for a vehicle. He said, so let's have lunch in a month and you can tell me what you're doing next. And in the meantime, keep the car. And that meant so much to me, not just because I didn't have to go buy a car, but also because it was this expression of support. And he signed on through different dealerships as the very first sponsor on the new show on Real Talk. So that was one example that was amazing. And Friesen Brothers Grocery and others that came over and I continue to endorse their products. And then, of course, there was real interest from people that were intrigued by what we were doing, independent, new digital streaming media, and wanted to get in that space and wanted to be in from the ground floor. And so we've had great partners. I happen to know because I was just looking, we just had a business meeting shortly before I was talking to you. We've had 39, we just, as a matter of fact, agreed to terms, haven't signed the contract yet, so I don't want to jinx it, but our 40th advertiser, and we've been on the air for 11 months. And that to me is really incredible. And then a team of people that were amazing. Chris Henderson from Y Station, chief strategist over there, and Adam Rosenhart, who's a veteran in the podcasting space in Alberta and a master storyteller. Catherine O'Neill and Jenny Adams of Adams Agency, and Adam O'Brien, who's the founding CEO of our title sponsor, Bitcoin Well. But he's a real, Adam's like a I know that the phrase, everyone rolls their eyes now, but he's a real disruptor, that guy. And he was the guy that was like, whatever you're doing, whatever your rate is, we want to be the title sponsor. We believe in you. He said, take detailed notes of everything that's going on right now. He said, because I do believe that 10 or 15 years from now, you are going to write a book about this and you're going to need those notes. And I mean, these were the types of people that were stepping up in a huge way to provide counsel and opinion. And then we partnered up with a web designer, Mike Johnson, and Josh Dunford, who's our managing director with BurnKit, an agency in Vancouver, and then Sam Brooks, who remains our technical producer. And they solved all the stuff that I'm lousy at, all the tech stuff, the digital stuff, the streaming stuff, solved a lot of problems. Our goal was to make it free content, easily accessible, easily streamable, to remove as many barriers to entry as possible.
And that's what I love about what you've done. You did it quickly. You had smart people who got this up and running really quickly. Nobody else is that I can see is really, you know, doing it every day, bringing that what is traditional broadcast content, putting it up from an Alberta and from a Canadian point of view. So you've gone and filled in this spot, which obviously led to a lot of number one positions, you know, in the Apple charts, for instance, finding you on YouTube. I want to talk about the audience and how did you get them to find the Purple app on their phone so they could listen to you? Because we talked about Central Alberta, and Central Alberta has had the John Deere tractor on 790 CFCW since the dawn of time in West Montgomery. Now we've got them plugging into the phone and downloading and listening to your show. So how did you get them to make that jump?
Yeah. And how do I continue to work to get them to make that jump? It's a question that you could leave that question open-ended. And my answer hopefully will become more and more intuitive as time goes. To be honest with you, I'm still figuring it out. This is all new. There's not been a business model for this really before. And we've had some wins and some losses and some swings and some misses, to be honest with you. You know, like the dude might say, strikes and gutters, right? And so a big part of that was, like you said, I mean, the one theme you've just developed ties into the other. And that was we had to do it quickly. And so we were 7 weeks from me getting fired to me back on the air, so to speak. And that was important because the story and my name and the whole thing around the firing, I mean, people perceived there to be, and this has been widely reported. This is my opinion, but I think it's shared by people that there had been an injustice and that the firing was BS. And people felt, I mean, I had messages, my emails and my phone. It was just wild for, you know, through that period of my 2 week suspension and then my firing. And when I was gone for a while, people were saying that they didn't like that I got canceled, but they said they felt like they got canceled because they had connected with that radio show and they felt like their show had been taken away. And so it was important to communicate quick. what we were going to do and where you could find us. So we simply put out ryanjespersen.com, which I had owned, obviously, and made it simple to use as it remains to this day. Click here to watch, click here to listen, click here to subscribe. You know, sort of spelling out very briefly and quickly what the Patreon is all about, but not making it convoluted, not making it confusing. I responded to a tweet, and this is a better example, just a few days ago. People can check it out on my Twitter timeline. This guy reached out, I can't remember his name, 74 years old. He says somebody had to show him how to connect with the show because he was a longtime listener of the radio show. Somebody showed him how to download podcasts. Now he says he doesn't miss a day. And he's like, you're back. He's like, we're back. And I just thought, we are all that guy. Like, when you connect with something, it's special. That was really special for me to hear. But yeah, I mean, people still, I had a lunch with one of our big sponsors just the other day. And he's like, you got to show me how to get so Real Talk can stream in my vehicle. And so we go out and I'm like, okay, well, the Mixler audio app, it's a live streaming audio app. And here's how you can do it. And now you can stream me while you drive, just like you'd listen to AM radio, except it sounds better.
I didn't know that one. So that's one I could do. By the way, quickly, do you still have a Mercedes?
No, I'm driving a Jeep Grand Cherokee.
So I'm driving a Mercedes, which comes with all the latest tech. And the reason why I bought the car is because it was going to be at the front end of all the tech that's coming into the car. I did not know about the Mixler that you were mentioning about.
Mixler's big for us. Like, we've had times where I remember when Podbean sent us, it was after our 154th episode, Podbean sent us our 2 million download badge. And we've since surpassed 3 million, which was amazing. But it got me thinking. I thought, you know, it's been a while since we tabulated where we were at with YouTube. Like, that was just podcast downloads was 2 million. And so we tallied up the YouTube and got a sense of where we were at with that. And then I said, what about Mixler? Because it sort of seemed like this afterthought. And we learned that more than 200,000 people had streamed on Mixler. And I was like, this is a thing. It kind of had become, in my mind, I would always say, watch us on YouTube or subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. And then it's like, oh yeah, live every day from 10:30 Eastern to 12:30 Eastern, or from 8:30 Mountain to 10:30 Mountain. We're streaming live, and you can treat it like live radio, and more people are doing that. It was always on my radar, Matt. Working in AM radio, it was not lost on me that fewer and fewer people are tuning to AM radio, and more people are getting their content on demand, streaming in a way that works for them. And of course, we knew that was coming. And I remember my first few friends to get Teslas or some of the higher-end luxury cars would say, man, there's not even an AM option in my car anymore. And that's devastating. So it was all over my radar before we even started doing this. Now we're just capitalizing on it.
How do you get guests? Because I think a lot of people who are in the podcast space are like, oh, you know, getting guests. There are actually companies that are built to get you guests, but you're obviously a little bit different. We know what to expect. But the Prime Minister, Mark Messier, Peter Mansbridge, who's booking this stuff?
The short answer is my editorial producer, Sarah Hoyles, who does an amazing job. You know, to be honest, I mean, yeah, it was awesome to have Messier. It was great to have the Prime Minister the day after the federal budget. I've got Justin Trudeau on the show on April 20th on 420 talking about smoking weed. Nobody else is doing that, I'll tell you that much. But what I was really proud of is the morning after the most recent Alberta municipal elections, we had the mayors-elect from Calgary and Edmonton, Jody Gondek and Amarjeet Sohi, give us exclusive one-on-ones the morning after. Nobody else had them. That to me is so important. We would communicate back in the day on my terrestrial radio show that this was Alberta's show of record. And in my opinion, that doesn't come with the time slot or the station. That comes with the host. And that comes with who's on the show, and it comes with where the audience goes. And so in my opinion, Real Talk is the show of record. And you can make that claim if you're getting the interviews people aren't getting, and if you're getting the quotes that people aren't getting. And so when it comes to getting guests, Sarah and I work together. She does a great job hustling to make that show happen and to have great guests every single day. You know, I'm looking ahead to tomorrow's show. We've got Jody Wilson-Raybould coming on. We've got big Bruce McCullough from Kids in the Hall. I mean, these are the interviews people care about. But the more interviews you get, like getting a guy like Justin Trudeau on is huge, because then all of a sudden you're saying to other people, you may have caught our episode the other week with the Prime Minister. We'd love to have you on. It adds to that credibility that the show has. And I mean, I think that we're still new to a lot of people, most particularly people in Eastern Canada. And the more that we're able to land those big interviews and continue to deliver quality journalism and talk on a daily basis, that's sort of a self-perpetuating cycle.
and a touch of human interest as well. One of the persons you had on your show was Christian Zip, who was my best friend when I was in Edmonton. And he had some tragedy afflict him in 2016, but you had him on the show. So it's not just politics and it's not just the news of the day, but, you know, human interest as well.
Yeah, Zip's survival story from, I mean, I feel like I'm sort of downgrading the magnitude of the story by saying his battle with meningitis, but it was like, I mean, the guy fought like hell to stay alive and is just a remarkable story. These are stories people care about. You know, one of our most downloaded episodes to this day is, and I know he wouldn't mind me calling him this because I've heard him refer to this. He's a no-name guy. He's a high school teacher that really cares about public education. And he came on one morning. He was recommended to me by several people who said, this guy is not an official public advocate, but he's a remarkable, compelling speaker and you have to have him on. I took a flyer. He came on. He breathed fire for like 30 minutes. And it was unbelievable. I mean, the last I checked, and I haven't checked for months, but that episode was closing in on 100,000 downloads itself. And so this was a guy that is far from a household name. And for me, it's like, yeah, the big names are great sometimes, but also it's the stories that captivate people. It's when people feel, I mean, with talk radio, I think what it does really well is it allows people to feel represented. And when people feel that they are represented, they connect with that content. And that's a big part of the story. Production of a show like this is a really, it's like a feel thing. It's like when you watch a conductor in front of a symphony, you know, in front of an orchestra, like it's a feel thing.
So when you're looking at your metrics, and I'm very curious about your metrics, so I'm sure that they're quite big in Edmonton. I'm sure they're just marginally smaller in Calgary. And how does it roll out across the rest of the country? And how far do you want to take Real Talk across the country?
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate that question. You know, I treat it like a national talk show. I want it to be seen as a national talk show. And we want a national audience. And we're building a national audience. And we see evidence of that. Like, we know that the number of people that engage our content from BC and Manitoba and Ontario and the Maritimes is significantly higher than it was back when we launched on November 23rd of last year. But still, yes, it is predominantly a Western Canadian audience. And for that matter, it's predominantly an audience based in Alberta. Now, one of the real challenges that I've had, full disclosure, to be an open book here, is that Alberta's politics have been a story of national interest for the entire time that we've been doing this show. And so it's pretty difficult for me to ignore a lot of what's going on here. Because if you take a look at what all the national, so-called national shows are doing, a lot of that centers on Alberta too. But I do lie awake at night because you got to try to find, you want to find that delicate balance. What's going to compel somebody in St. John or somebody in Hamilton or somebody in Churchill to download the Real Talk podcast or watch us streaming live every day in so many ways as somebody from Alberta might want to do the same? And one example of that would be with those mayoral elections, Calgary, Edmonton, and across Alberta municipalities. We dedicated one show to it. That was it.
Actually, the last question of the show we already answered, and the question was, why is Alberta such a dumpster fire?
Jason Kenney.
Ryan, congratulations on Real Talk. And I mean, it hasn't even been a year yet.
No, November 23rd will be, we've just passed 200 episodes. I don't know exactly how many we've done. But yeah, just past 200, and we'll see our one-year anniversary on November 23rd of this year.
It's an incredible story. It's very well thought out. Nobody is doing it in Canada. I have not checked the French language in Quebec, so I don't want to get emails about the whole thing. Because I can assure you, somebody in Quebec City is definitely doing something like this.
Yeah. Well, hey, if my French was better, I'd love to do a crossover with them. I've always regretted not, you know, I'm the son of a French teacher. My dad was a physician. My mom was a French teacher. And I've always regretted there's two things in life that I let slide and lost. And that was my ability to speak French and my ability to play the piano. And I wish I could do more proficiently now.
Ryan, thanks so much, man. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you know what? Your interest and the invitation means a lot. I appreciate it as well. Thanks, brother.
The Sound Off podcast is written and hosted by Matt Kundel. Produced by Evan Serminski. Social media by Courtney Krebsbach. Another great creation from the Sound Off Media Company. Imaging courtesy Core Image Studios. There's always more at soundoffpodcast.com.